one church at Bethel's family, a real church for real people. Can you believe it's already February 2023? And it's Black History Month. All month long, we will bring you facts about Black history, but with a twist. We are celebrating our own Black history makers right here in One Church at Bethel's family. Send us a picture and your story about paving a better way for our people. Now, you can email this at ldixon@bethelsfamily.org. Let's find out what else is going on with the fam. The Legacy Challenge is here, and yes, it's about paying off Bethel's mortgage, but the vision is way bigger than that. Check it out.
Hi, family. Listen, I am so glad to bring all of us in and bring us up to speed. Today, I want to talk to you about the One Church 2023 Legacy Challenge for the body of Christ where we are. God has been so faithful to this church in 29 years, and the history of our church is extensive. Please go to the website when you get an opportunity and see all that the Lord has done. It's beyond my imagination that God would use us to do that. But the One Legacy Challenge starts off when we use the baseball diamond. First base is that our heart would be that every person of Bethel's family have a personal relationship with the Lord that's growing and maturing. According to the scripture in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12, that we no longer be children or infants tossed back and forth by every wind of doctrine, but to be fully mature in Christ Jesus. That's base number one. Base number two deals with the scripture that God says the church need to be the lender and not the borrower. Over the last 29 years, God have done some incredible things. And the value of all of our properties, just under 25 acres, over 20 acres on the campus of the Foundry and Southwest location, and 3 acres of our retreat center in Pearland. When we look at 2022, February to be exact, the appraisal value on all that we have is $15 million and some change. And that doesn't include the content of what we have in our buildings. And then if you add the additions of what we've done in the last year, add the increase of real estate, it would put us just under $20 million of asset. But we have a $4.5 million loan that we want to go ahead and pay off within the next 12 months. So we do have a legacy challenge, and we're asking members and households and families to step up and join us. When we talk about the diamond level, we're looking for 50 households to commit to $5,000 or above over the next 12 months. We look at, from there, we go to platinum. We're asking those families to commit to $4,000 a year for the next 12 months. And then we go from gold, $3,000. We go to silver, $2,000. And bronze, $1,000. So every family, every household can commit to this legacy. Third base come in, where we're asking individuals that we truly need to prepare for not being here upon the earth. I'm a realist. Job said, man born of a woman is only of a few days, and these days are filled with so much trouble. I'm the senior pastor of our church, and I've buried a lot of people. I've counseled a lot of people. And one of the things we must do, we must get prepaid plans for even our funerals. So we're going to be bringing in insurance individuals. We're going to be bringing in funeral homes to partner, maybe in a group way, that we can save a lot of money, that every person, every family member of the body get the needs done and get it done quickly and proficiently and professionally. And then the final thing is that fourth base that deal with the actual wills and trusts. We're all going to leave a legacy of some form. We're all going to leave some material things behind. Some cash, some cars, some houses, stocks and bonds, and the whole nine yards. And you have to be very clear on who you want to be able to be the one who would drive your remaining goods, and how you want them to be shared, whether with children, whether with family members or friends, or even if you wanted to donate things to your church, it still need to be in a writing of a will or a trust in some form of format. And so that's one of the things we wanted to come to you on. There will be other Zoom trainings that I'm doing currently, and they're pretty much Right now, every other night, there will be a schedule that will go out. You will get an email with several scheduled times. Please, ma'am, please, sir, click on to one of those Zooms. We normally do it between 8 p.m. and 9 p.m. nightly when they are available. I don't keep you over an hour, so I can go a little bit more in detail about the legacy that God has provided for our church. Now remember, the One Church 2023 Legacy Challenge is not for some of us, it's for all of us. And trust me, family, the best for us is still yet to come. Thank all of you, God bless you, and the Lord's will, God will get the victory. Thank you.
Now that you know what the Legacy Challenge is all about, make a run for first base. Now listen closely to Pastor Walter August Jr. because what he has to say will change your life.
My oldest son, Walter, he was 4 years old, and we had just bought a house in Missouri City. And this was in 1998. And I remember on a Sunday, I'm working two jobs, and I wanted to build a little wash house in the backyard, and I had bought all my materials from a Home Depot, and I was going to use Sunday to start building my little wash house in the backyard. And Ruby had gotten Walter and Patrick together, and I was had my nail bag on, my jeans. I'm going, they getting ready to go to church. I'm getting ready to go in the backyard. And I heard Walter say, I don't want to go to church because I want to be like my father. I heard that. God allowed me to hear that and reminded me of just how important the salvation of my children was and how they were looking to me to be that example. And I came back in the house and I told Ruby, I said, listen, give me 15 minutes. I went and heard and got cleaned up and changed. And we went on to True Light Missionary Baptist Church where we've been going. And we just didn't just go to worship. We went to Sunday school. We made sure we were there, whatever programming, because God was truly real in my faith and in my life. And even to the point where even when I would miss church, I would feel on the inside that I was missing something. And I was blessed enough to marry a woman that was already had a yearning and yielding for the Lord as well. So it made it quite easy for us. And as we look at how God has used our life with our children, all of our sons are in the Lord Jesus. God became real because he called me into the gospel ministry, but I started serving way before the call, whether in food pantry, whether we were serving as ushers and greeters, junior deacons. So God ran us through the gamuts of the body of Christ to give us a foundation that is sure. Why is it so important that every person really begin to look at their faith walk with God? That's where it starts. It starts with a commitment individually to follow the teachings and the Word of God. So it impacts your life to have a permanent blessing and future for generations to come.
And now, what you've all been waiting for, One Church, a story about faith and obedience.
Family, let me start off with this. There's a decision that's been made that I'm going to retire in about 15 months. In March 6th, so the first Sunday in March of 2024, there will be a new pastor in this pulpit.
Trust and believe.
How do I feel spiritually about stepping out of the pulpit? I don't see myself stepping out of the pulpit per se.
So I'm coming out of my comfort zone.
Shock? Like, you know, again, he said he went down the pulpit.
I'll walk alone. God is challenging.
I'm going to be all over the state of Texas. I'm going to be all over the nation and around the world.
For to go where I'm not gone, I
After I got past that initial shock, it was just excitement about vision.
The One Church model, as Dr. Scott, as Scott and I were dialoguing, the Great Commission is very clear on what our assignments are as a church. The church sits on two pillars. One is the Great Commandment, loving God with our everything and loving our neighbors as we love ourselves. Then the Great Commission that we are under, and that's to go out and lead people to Christ, baptizing, you know, commanding that they follow what Jesus have called for us to do.
That point you make about the church is being strong is right on point, because there could be some thoughts about this side needs that, this side needs that. No, two churches who just believe that we can do a great work to the glory of God. And I think it's a beautiful story, a story that actually started some time ago. I think it's good to look back and kind of see some of that story, the start of Bethel's family.
Go now to Bethel's Family TV on YouTube and check out One Church, a Story About Faith and Obedience docuseries. And be sure to tell us what you think on Bethel's Family Facebook or Instagram. Make sure you give us a thumbs up and share. Here's a look at what's going on with the fam.
Biblical Manhood is back, 2.0, starting on Monday, 7 p.m., right here at the Church of Bethel's Family. We're going to be starting a 20-week series called The Lion and the Lamb. We're going to be talking about how do I discover who I am in Christ, talking about how to overcome temptation, love, lost, and lust. Going to be talking about how to get our money right so that we can live the effective life in Christ, how to be great fathers, how to be effective husbands, how to be the men that God has called for us to be. I need you to be in the place every single Monday right here at the Church of Bethel's Family. I'm Pastor Holman. I'm going to be walking with you. See you there.
As you can see, we are busy doing God's work here at Bethel's Family. Now make sure you're doing your part. Start with the Legacy Challenge, make your way to first base so that you are one step closer to the promises God guaranteed in His Word. Make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel and Facebook, or visit the website bethelsfamily.org to stay in the know. I'm your sister in Christ, Yolanda R. Williams. Be blessed and stay in prayer.
Good morning, Bethel's family. It's great to see all these lovely faces. Can everybody stand up? God gave us one more chance. Amen. So the song we're going to sing is called He Reigns. How many know that He reigns in our lives? Over every circumstance, over every situation, over our children, over our money, over our business. So you guys join in and help us with this little praise song, okay?
You're right. church, say amen. And amen again. Amen. What day it is today. Hallelujah. Let's just bow our heads as we go to the Lord this morning. Our Father and our Lord, the Alpha and the Omega, the Lord of Lords, to the King of Kings, to the Maker and the Creator. Father, we come into you right now, Father. First of all, just give thanks. Thanking you for being such an awesome God. Thanking you for being an on-time God. Just thanking you, Father, for just being God all by yourself. Father, we want to thank you, Father, because you watched over us. Father, we lay in the image of death. Master, you kept us from harm and danger. Father, you allowed everything to happen according to your will. So, Father, right now we just ask you, Lord, to just say thank you. Father, we know within our hearts, Master, there's goodness and wickedness. Heavenly Father, touch our hearts today. Because, Father, we're in need of a heart fixer. Father, you said we all have sinned and fallen short of your glory. Father, right now, forgive us of all our shortcomings. Father, for those that have mistreated us, Father, please forgive them. Father, we need you right now, Father. Oh, Father, where we're weak, give us strength. Father, even if we're torn down, Master, just build us up today. Father, continue to control our tongues today and continue to guide our footsteps. Oh, Father, we need you right now, Master. Oh, Father, reach out into the hospitals, Master. Father, we know that you're the answer to the cancer, all the sickness and the illness, Master. So, Father, we need you right now, Father. Oh, Father, heal right now in the mighty name of Jesus. Father, remember the Marks family. Father, we know that you're still in total control, Father. Let them know, Father, it's not over till you say it's over. So, Father, be that comforter. Be that provider, Father. Give them the strength that they need. Oh, Heavenly Father, bless the choir today. Bless the message today. My Father, give us the wisdom and the knowledge, Master. But most of all, give us all a better understanding. So, Father, right now, we just ask you, Lord, just open up some doors, Master. Father, we need you to close some doors today. Father, watch over that sinner man, woman, boy, girl, Master. Confusion is all in the land, Master. But, oh, God, it's good to serve a God of peace. So, Father, right now, just bring peace out of confusion. Oh, Father, right now, we bring it all back to the altar, Master. All of our sickness, all of our pain and our suffering, all of our trials and our tribulations. Oh, Heavenly Father, we bring it all back to the altar, Master, that, Father, we'll be mindful enough, Father, to give you all the praise, Masters, to give you all the honor. Oh, Heavenly Father, to give you all the glory, that we ask these many blessings in your Son Jesus' name. Heavenly Father, the church said amen and amen again.
me hear you say thank you, Jesus. Let me hear you say thank you, Jesus.
say, oh, the blood. Say, all the blood,
oh, the blood
of Jesus. How many know that it has the power to save and raise?
Oh,
the blood
of Jesus.
Of Jesus.
Power.
The song says, it reaches
yes.
to the highest mountain. And it flows to the lowest valley.
Would y'all stand, family?
The blood.
That's it,
The blood.
Yes.
Wonder working blood. That saving blood. That power. For blood, it flows to the lowest valley. The blood that gives me strength from day.
And family, as the choir makes their way on down, we want to lift up the Marks family to you. This morning there at the hospital, their daughter Melanie is deceased. And I don't know how you can fathom having to be at a hospital on a Sunday morning for folks to tell you your baby girl is no longer here. There's a lot of others who are in need of prayer as well. You know, it's just devastating when you have to bury your kids. I was blessed to be in Louisiana, Abbeville yesterday for the homegoing service of Deacon Minor Wright, who was 102 years old. Celebration of a great life. And then when morning come, we have now parents and grandparents now have to bury a child or grandchild. But it's just not here in this church, in this family, This stuff is impacting every family in every community. And that is why it's so important that we don't procrastinate on making the main thing the main thing. But if you don't mind, would you bow with us as the choir continue to come down? I promise you, nobody can do you like Jesus. Absolutely nobody. He is a friend that stick closer than any brother. And with him, all things are possible. Most gracious Heavenly Father, we just say thank you, Lord. Thank you, God, for just holding on to us in a season like this one. Father, there are tons of things we don't know anything about. There are tons of things we can't control. But Father, we serve a risen Savior. We serve the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. So we come to you, God, as mere children, God, sons and daughters of the King. God, we confess, God, that we fall short of your ways. And we ask right now in the name of Jesus, God, would you please forgive us, God, of all sins, iniquities, and transgressions. Any and everything, God, that contradict your word, your will, or your wishes, God, remove it from us, O Lord. So, God, our prayers would not be hindered, God. So right now, God, we lift up families that are going through tars and storms, families that are going through, God, a rough patch right now. So many are caught between a rock and a hard place. But God, we know you're able, Master, to do anything but fail. So we ask, God, in the name of Jesus, Father, would you touch every family as we lift up the Marks family to you, God. Touch that father, that mother, God, these siblings, God, these grandparents, God, nieces, nephews, these cousins, God, the body of Christ, God. Touch right now, God. I know you can do it, Master. I know you can do it. So, Father, give them what they need right now. Cover Pastor Holman as he ministers to him right now, Lord. Crown him right now, God, with your wisdom, God. Let the words that come out of his mouth, God, be your words, God. And let your power in your word, God, begin to provide some sense of healing, God, right now in the name of Jesus. And Father, around the world, God, all around the world, others who are in that same predicament, or even worse, we ask, God, that you be glorified today. Now, Father, here at Bethel's family, what you're doing here in this one church, God, you do what you need to do, God. We're just mere servants. We ask to cover Harvest Point this morning as we're praying in to what it means truly, God, to be one in Christ, God, one in faith, Lord, one in missions, one in vision, God. Because, Father, we know it's only one God, is only one faith, God, is only one baptism, God, is only one heaven, God, is only one Jesus, there's only one God, real God, there's only one Holy Ghost, God, there's only one Bible, God, there's only one Master. It's only one Master. So you speak, Lord, and we'll be ever so mindful and careful to return all praises, all glory, all honor unto you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And we say amen and amen. Thank you for standing, family, for a few more minutes, if you don't mind. Just want to go ahead and acknowledge all those who are visiting this morning. If you're visiting this morning, we thank God for you. If you're visiting, we just want you to just wave at me. Let me know you're here. You just came in, say, I'm going to participate with Bethel's family this morning. I see a few hands out here. What a blessing. Thank you all so very much for visiting with us today. We know there are thousands of churches in Houston that you could have stopped by and you could still go to, but we appreciate you putting Bethel's family on your schedule. Inside the program that you have, inside to the right, there's a place that says contact information. If you don't mind, please, ma'am, please, sir, write a name, a number, a phone number down there. And if any of those boxes underneath apply to you, just check those boxes off. And we already have a crease there, so just tear it off as best as you know how. And during our offertorial time, please, ma'am, please, sir, just place it in the offertorial box. And the Lord's will, before 10 p.m. tonight, I will personally give you a call, if it's for nothing more but to thank you for being a part of our church family. So welcome to Bethel's family. You're so welcome in God's house. Family, our message today, on the first Sunday in February, comes from the book of John, chapter number 17, verse 20 through verse 26. And then we pick up a few more verses in Ephesians 4, verse 4 through 6. But in John 17, verse number 20 says this, I pray not only for these, but also for those who believe in me through their word. May they all be one, as you, Father, are in me, and I am in you. May they also be in us, so that the world may believe that you sent me. I have given them the glory you had given me, so that they may be one as we are one. I am in them, and you are in me, so that they may be made completely one, that the world may know you have sent me and have loved them as you have loved me. Verse 24 says, Father, I want those you have given to me to be with me where I am, so that they will see my glory, which you have given me because you love me before the world's foundation. Righteous Father, the world has not known you. However, I have known you, and they have known that you sent me. I made your name known to them and will continue to make it known, so that the love you have loved me with may be in them and I may be in them. In the book of Ephesians, the Apostle Paul began to speak to us in chapter number 4, beginning there at verse 4, you're going to see these kind words from the apostle, tying us all in together as one. In verse number 4, he says, there is one body and one spirit, just as you were called to the one hope at your calling, one Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God, the Father of all, who is above all and through all and in all. May the Lord add a blessing to the readers and hearers and doers of his awesome word. You may be seated, family. Family, we thank God again for all of you. And our message today is that we are one in Christ Jesus. We are one in Christ Jesus. Family, I don't have to tell you, you've been walking with Jesus for a while. I don't have to tell you that the world that we're living in is a world filled with devices and divisions. Even in our personal families, people that are connected by blood or by marriage even struggle with just those cordial relationships. There are some generational gaps that keep one generation in the family from connecting with the other. And even there are siblings that begin to rival against each other. And the Bible has already said that there would be tensions between fathers and sons, tensions between mothers and daughters. And all through the ranks, Satan has worked faithfully to destroy the oneness that's in the body. And you know for a fact, these physical bodies of ours, Deacon White was with the deacons this morning, and I happened to go by the coffee bar, and Deacon White was sharing that he had went and got a checkup on his body, and just kind of checking all the vital signs and the organs, and he began to talk about You know, he left his doctor with four prescriptions. And then, not to be topped off, Deacon Chapman say, man, you ain't got nothing. I take seven medications every morning. Well, it's just like these physical bodies that we have. The longer we live, there'll be some things on the inside that just gonna shut down. Because it only can actually travel in this land so far. But that's the physical body. But unlike the physical body, there is a spiritual body. There's a spiritual life that God wants you and I to rise to. And that's that spiritual sense where the oneness can come regardless of what affiliations or what side of the tracks you were raised on, your ethnicity, your pedigree, your academic success. This is one area we can all come together and be one, but it takes the spirit and the power of God to bring oneness. Now, in Jesus's day, you got to remember there is adversarial forces to try and keep him from fulfilling the very purpose by which he had been called. He was sent to the earth with a purpose to unite sinful man back into a right relationship with God. And believe it or not, it might surprise you, but there are people that don't want to see unity. There are people that are living on the face of the earth that don't want to see even the body of Christ be one. And they'll fight tooth and nails. They'll let Satan use them as a device to keep the body from being one. The book of John, from chapters 1 all the way out to chapter 20, you begin to see that John writes in this gospel as Christ inspired the very life of Christ. The first chapter, if I had to give a theme for the first chapter, it would be that God is here. That means you're not by yourself. You're not alone, because the Word, the light, and the Son of God, the Lamb of God, God is here. Chapter 2 comes in and begin to tell us that we can learn more about Christ, more about his ways, that he is the Messiah, that he has the glory, that he has the zeal to finish the work that God has called for him to do. Chapter 3 going to tell you that it's a matter of life and death. It's a decision that you got to make upon your own, that you can choose to live eternally with him, or you can choose to go and spend the rest of your time in eternal hell. He comes in to let you know that it's vitally important that you walk in the light, but salvation is only through Christ Jesus. Chapter 4 will begin to tell you about his love for the Samaritans, those who were outcasts, those who weren't included in the plan of the new and way of the Judeans on how they thought. And even today, there's some people that still think they have a monopoly on God. But Jesus in chapter 4 of John says, I love the Samaritans. Chapter 5 will let you know that Jesus now is equal and has always been equal to God, because they are one. They're not separate entities. They are one. Chapter 6 began to look at Jesus. He's leading and preaching, and then there's a multitude of people that follow him, but many were following him for that piece of fish and that piece of bread. And many times people, after they eat, they leave. Chapter 7 speaks about disbelief in divisions. Wherever he is, wherever he's moving, there will always be a spirit on the inside for us not to get along. And some people spend all of their times looking for what's wrong and never enjoying what's right. Somebody ought to say amen. Chapter 8, Jesus speak about the Mosaic law versus God's amazing grace. If you remember the woman that was caught in adultery, it's the Mosaic law that said we ought to stone her to death. But God's amazing grace, he says, now you who are without sin, why don't you go ahead and cast the first stone? Chapter 9, Jesus miracles. And he did miracles only to give earthly people his credentials. Every time a miracle was performed, it's to let mortal man know that I am the Son of the living God. I can walk on water. I can turn water into wine. I can raise the dead. I can heal. I can give sight back to a blind man. So when he did his miracles, he was letting you see his credentials. In other words, it was his resume. Chapter 10, he comes in and lets you know that I am the good shepherd. And I take care of the sheep. And I lay my life down for the sheep. Chapter number 11 comes in. And his last miracle was proving that he's the Son of the living God. He, amen, raised Lazarus back from the grave. Chapter 12 come in and speak about man's crisis and the Christ that can deal with the crisis that man had. He began to share with them, I'm the only one you need. Chapter 13, you begin to see the sovereign servant. You look at his humility. You look at his holiness and the joy and happiness that he brought people. You begin to look at chapter 14, and Jesus says, now is a good time for you to understand I can speak to your grief. I can heal the brokenhearted. That's why in John 14, he says, don't let your heart be troubled. If you believe in me, believe also in God. He says, in my Father's house, got something for you. Chapter 15 come in and Jesus speaks about the relationship and the responsibility that believers have. You just don't wake up every morning as a believer and go on about your merry way as though you have no responsibilities and you have no, amen, relationship. Because when you're saved, you're in the body of Christ. When you're saved, you're my brothers and sisters of the Father that we serve. When you're saved, you're in a bigger family than just your earthly family. Chapter 16, Jesus speak about the world will hate you, but amen, heaven just loves you. Come on now, say amen. He began to give the contrast between if you're going to live worldly, the world going to end up hating you, not because you are a bad person. It's going to hate you because you identify with him, with Jesus. And sometimes, family, you cannot, amen, take the world and take Jesus and try to mix them together. Amen. It's oil and water. They just don't mix. One of the things the Bible is very clear, either you're going to, amen, serve the master who is righteous, or you're going to end up serving Satan and end up missing out on some opportunities. Now we finally get to chapter 17. And Jesus now prays for himself. He prays for himself because he knows it's important for, even for him as an example, to always have a conversation with his heavenly Father. And you and I are beneficiaries of watching Jesus talk to his Father. And he began to share with him and talk about his disciples, about their shared life together. And yes, we know his name, and yes, we know his word, but also in chapter 17 at the beginning, you begin to realize that Jesus set the ultimate example of what it means to be one. My Bible tells me that he came to seek and save those which were lost. John 3:16 say he died not for some but for the entire world. If those who believe, whosoever would believe in him would not die but have eternal life. He died for the whole world. It didn't matter about how you got here, didn't matter about your past experience, but if you accept me, I can take you where I am myself. The other thing that he comes in when he talks about praying for himself, but then he prayed for his current disciples, Peter, James, John. He prayed for them, even prayed for Judas. He prayed for them that God would protect them, that God would provide what they needed, that God would sanctify them by the truth of his word, that God would keep them. And even though he knew he was going back to the Father, he wanted the Father to know that those you've given me, I still have them, except the one that was, amen, labored for destruction so that the scriptures can be fulfilled, but I kept them and I told them about you, and I loved them, I protected, I fed them. And so, Holy Father, as I come to you, God, protect them from the evil one. Put, amen, something on the inside of them and something around them to let them know that I never leave them, I would never forsake them, and then give them the gift of the Holy Ghost on the inside so we can all be one. Then he comes down to our current text and he says this very candidly. Now he's talking about you and I, because you and I are on the latter part of the prayers. Even before we were born, Christ prayed for us. Before our moms and dads, their moms and dads, and their moms and dads, he prayed for us. You had been prayed for before you got here. And that's his prayer for you and me. And he says, I pray not only for the believers that he had, but I also pray for those who will believe in me through their word. And he keeps saying that all of them will be one. Father, just like you and I are one, I want them to be one. Family, where did we come up with all these denominations? Why do we have to be competing as a church with another church? Why must pastors try to outshine each other? Why does some denomination feel that they have a hold of Jesus and nobody else can get him? Family, that's all man. That's not God. That's never been the will of the Father. The will of the Father is that we would be one. Now, next Sunday, there will be a Super Bowl game. I think in Phoenix, that's where it's going to be. That's what I heard. And there will be two teams. Pastor Lee's team and Brother Bro's team. You have the Eagles and you have the Chiefs. That day going to be a sea of green and a sea of red. Now, if Pat Mahomes throw a touchdown, the green team, but the red team, and vice versa. If Philadelphia runs a kickoff all the way to the end zone, touchdown, Pastor Lee gonna tear up the house. He have all of his family wearing green, including his little grandchildren. I mean, the whole house is decorated in green. And others like him will be celebrating. Wouldn't it be wonderful if all the Christians in Houston would come together as one and celebrate the risen Savior that we all say that we serve, that began to sing a song all together, every nationality, every pigmentation, every belief, come together in Christ and just give him the glory, give him the honor, give him the praise as one church, as one body, as one spirit, as one blood. Wouldn't it be awesome? Wouldn't it be awesome? Well, the oneness in Christ that he's asking and actually allowing us, he says, listen, I need for you to be one. One. And so let me just put this plug in. There need to be some deliverance. Because some of you, like many of my family members, you were raised up traditionally. You just believe in fighting. You come to church looking for something. Because see, you're at home. You can't even be the man in your own home. You go to work. You're not the boss over there. But you get over here and get a little title. Now that title began to blow you up and make you somebody that you really haven't been called. Because all of us are nothing but servants. If you think you're anything other than a servant, then you miss the whole Bible and the whole text. But it would be a blessing to see it in our lifetime. Oneness. Bethel's family, you on the cuff of being a part of history. Seeing a church and a church be one. Jesus says this. He says, I want them to be not just one, but completely one. One in purpose. One in missions. One in vision. And when the church is one, the body becomes stronger. Capable of doing extraordinary things. It's just like this hand. If I keep these fingers apart, I'm very limited with my strength to do any damage. But if I put them together, you make a feast with me if you put it together. Y'all know how to do this. y'all really know how to do this. If you put it together as the body of Christ say that we should, it would be hard for Satan to get a stronghold or foothold. You see, when you hold it like this, it's hard for Satan to pry a finger apart, because that's what he's trying to do, trying to find a weak link. But when we're holding each other together, then every turn Satan can get knocked out. And the Spirit of God can go forward. And what that does, it draws people to Him. And then you see near the end of the prayer, He says, I want you and I, talking to God, I want us to be known because I want them to be with me. I want them to experience my glory. I want them not only to know me while they're there, but I want them to be with me where I am. Nothing can be more promising when we see our children traveling behind us, heading home. Our children traveling behind us, headed home. My wife and I, we had to do what you do, and still doing it. We have to pray every day for our children. There's not a day that's going to go by when we're not praying for our children, praying for our grandchildren. And we just want them to be one. want them to come together. We want them to love one another. We want them to help each other. Nothing gives parents or grandparents joy like watching their children get along. It's devastating when your children are fighting. And that's all God wants us to do, is to love, support, and encourage each other. As you pray for my children, and I'm praying for your children, and we somehow link arms together as the body and keep all our children before us and before the Lord in prayer, and the prayers offered in faith can move the mountains that keep us from being unified. I'm going to ask my wife if she would come this way. Made it back from Abbeville, the birthplace of Christ. It's the Reuben I. We labor extremely hard, not for ourselves, but for our children, for their children. And we have committed, when we started this church, to keeping the ministry clean, keeping our bedroom clean. And now we're moving into that final year where 30 years of ministry will come next year around this time. And we've carried you a long way, an extremely long way. We have not failed you in our commitment to serve with the highest level of integrity, with the highest level of moral integrity, and the highest level of accountability. We taught you when you didn't want to be taught. We opened the doors even when you didn't show up. And we've done this consistently day in and day out. We have not slept outside of our home in 30 years of ministry. I didn't have to sleep on the couch in 30 years. Lord have mercy. She still loved to hear me preach. And she's here every Sunday. Somebody ought to say amen. So what she's getting at church is what she also get at home. But I want to introduce to you as a good steward, because I believe that God in his infinite wisdom, he want to give us a year to cause succession planning to happen right before your eyes. Well, if you're going to, we're going to go, we're not retiring per se to sit there and just wait on the mailbox. We will still be doing ministry. This will still be our church home. We're going to still be functioning in some capacity. But I'd like to introduce to you, reintroduce to some, our new, the second pastor that has already been anointed, but the appointment will be a year down the road. It's kind of like King David. And he has his entire family here this morning. And so Dr. Scott, Sister Shannon, can y'all just come up this way? the privilege of marrying that young couple. Family is everything. Yeah. See you. Hey, Mrs. Scott, good to see you. Hey, girls, y'all done grown on me. Y'all done got so big. What a blessing. Amen. God bless you. What a blessing. Hello. What a blessing. This is family. Dr. Scott was our youth pastor, our executive pastor, served faithfully. Left 8 years ago. We blessed him, but he's been working extremely hard in the midst of growing one of the largest, fastest growing churches in Pearland called Harvest Point. He continued to get his education. And I think it was 3 years ago now, you got your doctorate? 3 years ago, got his doctorate from Dallas Theological Seminary. Shannon, come on, Miss Shannon. Together, they are turning Pearland upside down with the Word of God. So I'd like for you to be able to hear from Pastor Scott, and he will introduce his own family.
Somebody say amen. 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 It's a good day. This is a good day. You may be seated. I want to introduce to you my wife for almost 18 years. Amen. Sister Shannon Scott. I'll go in order with the kids. The oldest is Kaylin, who's just made 15. Wave to the people, Kaylin. I said, you're almost 16, excuse me. She got her permit, so she thinks she's grown. Come on, somebody. Leah, step up, Leah, who's the second oldest. Leah is 14, amen? Celebrate, Leah. Eden is 12. Wave, everybody, Eden. Our first son. So the Lord blessed us with the three girls, and when we first had the kids, you know, we're excited. We're excited about all of them. So Shannon, you know, we'll go to the doctor to find out what we're having, and we go in there. Girl, God bless you, Lord. Thank you. Healthy baby. Second time, girl. God bless you. We're excited. Third time, girl. We're excited. Fourth time, baby, you go by yourself. Just call me with the news. But the Lord blessed us with our fourth child, Lawrence, our boy. Wave to the people. He's 10 years old. And then Zachary got his bow tie on. He's 6 years old. Wave, Zachary. And y'all knew this already. The one who runs everything is Reagan. She's 4 years old. Say hey or not. Amen. But just want to say thank y'all for your reception. I know this is a big deal. And I appreciate the word, Pastor, about this unity. One of the cool things we had a chance to assess is going back 18 years ago, after we were married across the street, as we were in transition looking for a new church home, we had this new marriage. The Lord brought us here to join in 2007. And I talk about this all the time. The first ministry before the youth pastor and all that, the first ministry that I was blessed to serve in is the chair ministry. Now, if you're here back 18 years ago, you would remember that the building was busting at its seams. And the only thing I would do when I showed up on Sunday morning was make sure that as we transition service that I put some chairs down. Come on, somebody. You don't need stages to serve. Amen. And so we did that faithfully. He invited me to be a part of the business ministry. And then we went to the evangelism ministry. And then I became a volunteer youth leader under, at that time, Deacon James Lee, Sister Lee. And then I had a chance to become the youth pastor. And then when I transitioned from my business world to the church, see what had happened was my income in the business world was right here. But I wanted to be faithful, and we came in to serve and took a little bit less. But in order to accommodate the transition, they also helped me be the director at Bethel's Family Christian Academy. And after those things, I became the executive pastor. And the pastor said something a moment ago. I want you to hear this. When I came to him about what the Lord was doing about planting a church in Pearland, this is what he said. Here's a check. Here are 200 chairs. Here's our name you could take with you as far as the legacy that we've already established. And then watch this. For the next 15 months, I was still on staff, receiving 4 times salary here while I'm pastoring out there. That's you talking unity? You know, some pastors, as soon as you say you finna go do something, they'll cut you off right there. But he blessed us. And the reason why Harvest Point is thriving today is because of the seed planted from this church, this pastor. You ought to celebrate our pastor, our first lady. Pastor and Sister August, thank y'all so much.
And while the Scots are up here, we're definitely going to be praying. But family, as you know, about our legacy challenge to go ahead and eradicate things in your envelope today. We've been sharing pieces of the One Church 2023 Legacy Challenge. We have to, this is our last 12 months, 13 months in the senior pastor role. Our church have been faithful over the last 29 years. We've acquired just under 25 acres of property. All of what has been amassed is over almost $20 million. I share it with you, a sum, and I share now that the church can never be owned by a person or a family. The church belongs to the people of God. It should always belong to the people of God. But we have 4 bases that we have to cover. The first base that's most important is to make sure that everybody in the body is saved. And they have a personal relationship with Christ. That's paramount. So we're going to continue to reach. We're going to be teaching. I'm starting on Wednesday. Pastor Holman and I will be teaching the Purpose-Driven Class 101 that go through and expand what it truly means to be saved, what it truly means to understand what baptism is, what the Great Commission and the Great Commandment of the church should be about. So we're going to be walking through that this month to make sure that the body of Christ is focused on winning the next wave of lost people to Christ. We are the soldiers and the warriors, and we're the vessels. We're the ambassadors that God is sending out to reach out to people that are dying without a relationship in Christ Jesus. Secondly, second base deal with, owe no man nothing but love. The only debt we have to have, according to Scripture, is love for our brothers and sisters. So we are actually planning on eradicating the debt of $4.5 million in the next 12 months. In your particular bulletin that you received today, there's a number of families we're asking to commit to $5,000 over the next year. $4,000, $3,000, $2,000, and $1,000. And they say we got 2,000 families here, so it shouldn't be hard for us to do. So I'm asking today, when you look at that commitment card, that's why we try to put it in your hands prior to today. Been talking about it for the last month, almost a month and a half. And Ruby and I, come here, honey. We have never, get on this side of me, baby, because there you go. We have never led this church from the rear. Our commitment
in this campaign was $25,000. And we've already paid that out. We don't lead from the rear, we lead from the front. Our office staff, our paid folks, along with our deacon ministry, we've picked up their commitment cards, and right now we're just under $300,000 in pledges at the moment. And then I heard some good news.
As we've been talking about unity and continue with the legacy, Harvest Point Church, which will be a second campus eventually, is committed to $75,000 to the campaign. The Scott family, another $25,000, for a total of $100,000 to sow where we are.
So the leadership is doing its part. Now we're asking you to do yours. Let's pray. Father in heaven, we thank you, God, for this day. We ask, God, in the name of Jesus, that you would touch the hearts of your people on this day. That, God, we'll be up, we go up above and beyond what you call for us to do. God, I know many have been blessed in this ministry over the years. We've shed some tears, we've laughed, we've praised, we've worshiped. God, we've danced, we've shouted. God, you've been faithful. So, Father, as we make this move, God, have our hearts. Because you said, God, wherever our heart is, that's where our treasure will also be. So, God, have our hearts today that you'll fulfill your purpose and your plans. And we'll be ever so mindful and careful, God, to return all praises and all glory and all honor unto you. It's in Jesus' name we pray. And we say amen. And amen. Couple things. Third base. This is when we're asking, I'm going to be working to make sure everybody have an opportunity to do some pre-need plannings. We all are going to eventually leave here physically. And I'll be meeting on a Zoom this coming Thursday at 8 o'clock with funeral directors, insurance folks, and lawyers, all on the same Zoom. I'm going to share with them what we're looking for. And what we're looking for is a proposal from them to give us a large group rate. So instead of every family running down to the cemetery, paying that $3,000, $4,000, $5,000, if we get in the group program, we're going to try to slash that in half. I'm going to be meeting with the folks down at Paradise South this week, because we got members who are out there, to see what acre or 2 acres that they can put aside just for us. So that's that phase. Then base four, you have to get your wills done. And we're going to be working to make that happen. So I wanted to pass that to you. You hear it first and foremost here. Because it's important, not for some of us, because I cannot complete my assignment till those four bases are completed. So when I fade out into other works of ministry in 13 months, you would not be able to say that Pastor August and our First Lady failed us. You won't be able to say that. Amen? Deacons, why don't you come? Family, I'm going to have you guys come on back down. Thank you all so very much. Take your time, ladies. Take your time. Beautiful family. Y'all going to have any more kids?
No.
And then no more? You know, we got a few more chairs. Don't you want to get them two other boys? What a beautiful family. Presentation of the Lord. Family, you have the entire year to fulfill your pledge. So challenge yourself over the next 12 months, because God will provide when you have a heart to see Him move. Amen. You know, let the deacons do that, and then we're going to partake in the Lord's Supper, and then I got one other announcement for you, because it is very imperative that all of us look for those who are partnering with the body of Christ to make a difference. You stop that smiling, bro. That's Brother Danny. He can't help it. And for those who are visiting, please, ma'am, please, sir, this is the time you put that little portion of the program that you cut off. Deacons, whenever you're ready, be ready. Is there a commercial that's going to be going on? I think they're going to do a commercial right here for us. Probably cover some of the same things I talked about. That's me.
Hi, family. Listen, I am so glad to bring all of us in and bring us up to speed. Today, I want to talk to you about the One Church 2023 Legacy Challenge for the body of Christ where we are. God has been so faithful to this church in 29 years, and the history of our church is extensive. Please go to the website when you get an opportunity and see all that the Lord has done. It's beyond my imagination that God would use us to do that. But the One Legacy Challenge starts off when we use the baseball diamond. First base is that our heart would be that every person of Bethel's family have a personal relationship with the Lord that's growing and maturing. According to the scripture in Ephesians chapter 4, verse 11 and 12, that we'll no longer be children or infants tossed back and forth by every wind of doctrine, but to be fully mature in Christ Jesus. That's base number one. Base number two deals with the scripture that God says the church needs to be the lender and not the borrower. Over the last 29 years, God have done some incredible things. In the value of all of our properties, just under 25 acres, over 20 acres on the campus of the Foundry and Southwest location, and 3 acres of our retreat center in Pearland. When we look at 2022, February to be exact, the appraisal value on all that we have is $15 million and some change. And that doesn't include the content of what we have in our buildings. And then if you add the additions of what we've done in the last year, add the increase of real estate, it would put us just under $20 million of asset. But we have a $4.5 million loan that we want to go ahead and pay off within the next 12 months. So we do have a legacy challenge, and we're asking members and households and families to step up and join us. When we talk about the diamond level, we're looking for 50 households to commit to $5,000 or above over the next 12 months. We look at, from there, we go to platinum. We're asking those families to commit to $4,000 a year for the next 12 months. And then we go from gold, $3,000, we go to silver, $2,000, and bronze, $1,000. So every family, every household can commit to this legacy. Third base come in, where we're asking individuals that we truly need to prepare for not being here upon the earth. I'm a realist. Job said, man, bone of a woman is...
Brother Vic, come on up this way, Vic Bono. Come on up this way.
I'm the senior pastor of our church, and I've buried a lot of people. I've counseled a lot of people. And one of the things we must do, we must get prepaid plans for even our funerals. So we're going to be bringing in insurance individuals. We're going to be bringing in funeral homes to partner, maybe in a group way, that we can save a lot of money, that every person, every family member of the body get the needs done and get it done quickly and proficiently and professionally. And then the final thing is that Ford base that deal with the actual wills and trusts. We all going to leave a legacy of some form. We're all going to leave some material things behind, some cash, some cars, some houses, stocks and bonds, and the whole nine yards. And you have to be very clear on who you want to be able to be the one who would drive your remaining goods, and how you want them to be shared, whether with children, whether with family members or friends, or even if you wanted to donate things to your church, it still need to be in a writing of a will or a trust in some form of format. And so that's one of the things we want to come to you on. There will be other Zoom trainings that I'm doing currently, and they're pretty much right now every other night. There will be a schedule that will go out. You will get an email with several scheduled times. Please, ma'am, please, sir, click on to one of those Zooms. We normally do it between 8 p.m. and 9 p.m. nightly when they are available. I don't keep you over an hour, so I can go a little bit more in detail about the legacy that God has provided for our church. Now remember, the One Church 2023 Legacy Challenge is not for some of us, it's for all of us. And trust me, family, the best for us is still yet to come. Thank all of you. God bless you. In the Lord's will, God will get the victory. Thank you.
See, I should have let the video did that. So I just had to do that first. But family, before we partake in the Lord's Supper, the last thing I wanted to do is do the Lord's Supper, because that's bringing us all in as one. But also, I have attorney Vic Bonner here. Many of you might know him. He is definitely connected to the Black Heritage Society, the parade, the whole nine yards for Dr. King. And one of the things that he does is when he engages clients at local churches, he have a give back to sow back in to wherever that person goes and attend church. So I just want him to share a minute or two so you'll know exactly who he is and what he offers.
Good morning. Good morning, Bethel's church, Bethel's family. My, what a good-looking group of folks this early in the morning. And I don't mind telling you, this is the first time I've gotten up this early to go to church. But I can tell by the number of people here this morning, too many people hang out last night, because you've got to get up early and come here. As Pastor said, I heard about this church for the first time about 3 weeks ago. I was riding Miss Duncantail. I was riding Beatrice Duncantail in the MLK parade. And in talking to her, I asked her what church does she belong to, and she told me she belonged to this church. And I'd never heard of you guys. I've been here all my life. I've never heard of you guys. But she started talking about this church, and she must have waxed poetic for about 35 or 40 minutes. And she talked in such glowing terms about what you're doing out here, and she's crazy about her pastor. And I said, well, look, I'll tell you what. Tell the pastor I want to invest in his ministry. I want to invest in his ministry, because this is a kingdom work personified. She said, I'll do better than that. I'll put you in touch with the pastor. So sure enough, she called the pastor. I talked to him, told him I wanted to do. He said, look, Lawyer Bonner, before you do that, I want you to come out here and I want you to meet me, meet some of the staff, let me show you around, and then we'll take it from there. So I came out last Friday, got here in time for lunch. After I finished lunch, Pastor sat down with me, and we cut it up for about 30 or 40 minutes. Cut it up. You know what I'm talking about. He's from Louisiana. I'm from Third Ward, so we know what we're talking about here. So after we got through chopping it up, he took me on a tour of the facility. I thought I was going to get a $5 tour, but I got a $100 tour. I mean, he took me upstairs. He took me around the corner. He took me through the dentist's office. Took me out back where the loading dock is. I mean, we went all over this place. We did everything but play some basketball. And I told him then, I said, look, the first chance I get, Pastor, I'd like to come out and talk to your congregation. So here I am. Last Friday, I came out and met him. Came to church last Sunday, so I'm not a complete visitor. And I'm back again this Sunday for 7 o'clock service.
And you're going to be back more time than you know.
I shall be back.
But I got to hurry.
I've got one question.
Yes, sir.
Not being a member of the church, not yet, can I participate in this challenge?
Yes, sir.
All right. With that being said, being a personal injury lawyer, if you send me your business, I'm going to pay tithes on my fees. All right? And let me tell you something. You may not believe this, but Jim Adler is not going to come out here. Them Christian lawyers ain't going to come out here.
But tell him, Dick, is that he don't charge you anything if there's no compensation.
Right. If there's nothing. If I can't get anything for you, there's no fee. All right? They're not going to come out here and touch the flesh with you, look you in the eye, and tell you that they're going to pay tithes on what they get. If they're going to pay tithes, they're going to pay it to that church. So let's do this thing 50-50, like Teddy Pendergrass.
Yeah.
Not 30-70, not 80-20, 50-50. You support me, I'm going to support you. And just to show you what my heart is, Pastor, I got $5,000 for you today. And it ain't no pledge.
Yes.
And it's not an IOU.
Yes.
You can take this to the bank tomorrow morning.
Deacons, come on. And he has a table set up out front, so if y'all want to stop by and get more information, please do that. Because we're going to support those who are supporting the house here. Amen? While the deacons are coming for our final thing, y'all can please stand. I want to go ahead and make sure that we get enough men for this, and I want you to put it on your calendar. The youth ministry... Pastor Ford is planning on actually doing a men and boys fishing trip for Galveston during spring break. It's a 3-day event where we'll be having brochures available so you can sign up. You can talk to Pastor Marcus Holman or Reverend Ford if you feel the need to sign up to come. We have a lot of young men who have never, ever been fishing, and we want to use that spring break to bind the young men with some godly men and let them enjoy 3 days in Galveston. Amen? We're ready.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound.
Beginning there, the 26th verse, it says, Jesus was eating with his disciples. He had taken some bread, broken and blessed, and said, take, eat, for this is my body. He took the cup, and he gave thanks, and he told his disciples, drink all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which was shed for the many for the remissions of sin. And to him who is able to keep us from falling, may the sweet holy commune, may it rest, rule, and abide with all of us here until we all come together again. Let us all sing.
Oh.